I will first talk about some of the motivation and the overall goal that I think I see actually to come. And then we will talk about challenges of the multi-view distribution. And I do want to talk about one particular solution, but also I hope I have time to talk about the second solution, because it's a really nice twist on the first solution, and then some discussion about future outlook, what we need to actually do next. So I do want to comment on the various aspects of content generation that is now happening. 3D cameras are getting much cheaper, and 2D cameras as well. And so what is happening is that you can actually start to think about equipping these kind of rooms with many, many different cameras. And then actually, particularly if you have 3D cameras, you can have geographically distributed sites, and you can merge that particular content into a joint 3D virtual space, so that basically the three people who are in these distributed locations surrounded by multiple cameras can actually appear as a joint virtual communication space. And so here you can see these are two patients in two different spaces, and then there is a doctor, and they can actually immerse themselves into a joint 3D space and conduct some physiotherapy or a dance, or we actually experimenting with some of these lightsabers. And I do want to show you a short video so that you get a little bit of a sense of, we worked also with the dancers. So these are actually two different spaces. We actually experimented with Berkeley and Illinois, but this is actually at Berkeley, one of the events we had. We set up two different spaces. And as you can see, the dancers in their different space with two cameras actually are basically being captured and then rendered into a joint space. So it's a multi-site calibration, 3D scene representation, and they actually show up in the same space. So these real-time 3D multi-camera content is allowing us basically these new 3D spaces, 3D video content, and in some way you can render it actually as a 360 video content that is then ready for distribution. So this is one sort of type of 360 video content that you can see. Another 360 video content that is currently coming is in the sports. And what you are ending up having is around the sports field, people are getting many, many different cameras. And what many of the broadcasters are now providing is that you actually can see different camera views, and they actually put them together. So you can see here a basketball game, and then on the side, for example, you can see the different views. So that kind of content, again, is available. What does happen at this point is that the content producers are producing these multiple contents, multiple camera views, store them, and then basically on demand, you sort of can retrieve them. But very often, actually, what happens is that there is a producer somewhere in the studio, if it is your NBC or so, and then moves the cameras and directs the content, right? So at this kind of multi-camera content, again, 360, you can imagine, is coming. And then the third multi-camera 360 video that is coming is really exciting. I think that's really the new frontier, is that many of the producers are and camera manufacturers are coming with these kind of cameras. So instead of having 3D camera like the Kinect, or having many 2D cameras sort of around the space, what the companies are now coming is a single camera, but it has basically multiple lenses. one camera, second camera, third camera, with four cameras, sometimes eight cameras. And you can actually hold it on a stick and then basically go around, and those particular cameras are taking videos from all over around you. So you can actually then get sort of a really nice view. Here is basically the view that you could see from this kind of camera, and it basically the video then gets stitched on a per frame basis, and you can then actually view this in a virtual reality. So at this point, the status of this particular multi-camera 360 video is that people are recording it. Basically, usually this system gets immediately attached to storage, and then people are actually writing editing software to actually stitch it together, store it then again on a YouTube server, and then on demand, you can actually view that kind of video. And I want to sort of show you, this is actually Game of Thrones, where you can see actually the video and you can move in sort of these particular spaces, and people are using it for animations, for all kinds of fun stuff. You can get quite sick when you are watching this too long. We have done some psychological tests, my students and I. So this is basically where the content generation actually is, that you can have multiple cameras, 3D cameras, render people together from different spaces, or you have a sports scenario and you have multiple views available to you, or you basically have here sort of 360 cameras all collocated, and then basically you can have video that is looking what your camera is see around, and you can decide basically what the content, sort of again, multiple contents are, views are available. So what I would like to talk about today is considering these tremendous advances that are coming in content, 360 content creation. The big question for me is the distribution of these desired views to large audiences. What currently happens is that these contents are now being generated and stored. And then basically people can on demand view it. But just imagine that you are at home having your remote, and instead of just switching between channels, you switch between views. Just think about NBC Olympic Games, right, in South Korea. Instead of waiting until your director, NBC director, sort of selects, this is currently sports you are going to be watching, this is the view, you actually at home, they have multiple cameras, you can actually watch that. Imagine that you are now having, you know, Berkeley and Illinois sort of dancers are creating a nice piece, and you could watch them and select, I want to see Renata, I want to see Lisa. So this is actually the goal. Whatever I'm going to show are more simulation emulations. But I actually see in 5-10 years, we might come that the broadcasting companies, the Comcast companies, and whatever companies have, I'm hoping that they will get to that particular point. Because the 360 video, and it's the same thing. You are, imagine you are in Venice and you are going with your 360 single stick camera, and your friends might want to sort of watch what are you seeing, and then choosing basically between the different views what you are watching. So that's actually what I want to talk about, some sort of initial approaches that we have been investigating on the distribution side, and engage also in the discussion if you have any suggestion, comments, and collaborations. I'm very open to, because this is actually a huge field, and I think that it takes a village to actually really solve this problem. So I want to talk about some challenges that at least we are seeing now, and I will address some of them, not all of them, since I have only limited time. But as I said, there are a lot of challenges I don't know the answer to. So the first challenge is, and I will actually show some of the solutions, the distribution solutions on the case of these teleimmersive spaces. So we actually know how to do two rooms that have multi-camera systems and other sort of sensors like audio and so on. You have these two rooms, they get connected over internet, you saw the dancers, basically render them into an interactive, immersive participants. But now I mentioned that I actually want to solve the problem that you have non-immersive viewers, right? There is somebody at home and wants to actually watch this new content that is being created, sort of a 360 type of sort of content. And you can have many of those, right? So you are in the non-immersive viewer space, you are talking about very large number of people. So you basically want to create then the whole distribution from maybe here, this particular content, and how does it basically get distributed in real time as this performance happens to these particular viewers. The second important issue I want to comment is to give you a feel for the model. And I think this is something that we will have to look at the 2D multi-camera spaces, the single 3D video 360, and in these teleimmersive spaces, the model of what are some of these views. So in the teleimmersive space, if the non-immersive viewer is seeing something, right, he's seeing the rendered dancers together. But this particular immersive view is basically composed out of camera content 6 and 5 of this dancer, and of the dancer camera, maybe 7 and 6, maybe 5 of the other side, right? Then basically you have to get together. If you are thinking about the video 360 camera on a single stick, right? It gets rendered, and then people are talking there about a model called tiles. And so you might need to compose tiles that are belonging to that particular view. So here I'm going to talk about streams, but things broader. And as I said, we need more research on this, but I just want to comment on that. And so in some way, you need to decide basically what information belongs to the view that the viewer wants to see. And in this particular case, it was camera 6, 5, and 4 from the one side, and camera 7, 6, and 5 from the other side. And you have these 3D streams that have frames, and you need to get those frames to the viewer. And so depending on the bandwidth, right, that you have available, you need to maybe decide which particular streams you are going to deliver to the viewer. And so one of the important things for us is then to really look at almost ranking of these streams. Ranking of the streams that contribute to the view that you want to see. Okay? So in this particular case, the camera 6 is going to be important, and the camera 7, right? So that you get two people together. And then the rest 5 might be important here, and 6 might be important here. And then the 4 and 5 here on the side might be a little bit less important. And this kind of ranking of the streams within the views will be important, because if you are dealing with resource constraints, you might actually know which particular streams to drop, right, that you don't have to deliver. So here, basically, you are then having one view. Of course, you can do that in the second view. And I think about this internet distribution system is when you watch something over internet, is you can get these various streams and you can change view, right? So I can basically now, maybe another viewer wants to see another view, right? Wants to see the view 4 and 3 here and 5 and 6 here. And we will talk about it, actually, when I get to the amphitheater solution, that this is going to be very important, you know, which views. Different people want to watch different views, maybe different event, different role of a person. And so again, for a different view, the ranking of the streams might be very different. So Another big important decision for the distribution is not only how am I modeling the view and the streams or the tiles to the view, but how am I organizing the real-time content generation and then its relation to the real-time sort of distribution and broadcasting, live broadcasting. We do want to do internet, and these are basically the viewers. And so one important aspect for us is that we actually, even in the producer tier, we have so-called gateway that does take these cameras together and then starts to render them, we distribute them, but also then we want to distribute these streams to this viewer space. And so that's a really major challenge. How do you organize this space, the producer space, and then this space in real time? I also mentioned that bandwidth is a big, big issue. You need to consider different viewers that might be on different devices, if it is the laptop or if it is a TV or other sort of viewing devices, maybe even wireless, now basically with older smartphones allowing sort of watching TVs. So the bandwidth, for example, here, even in the 18 frames per second, and the bandwidth usage sort of can go with 260 bits per second, that's sort of on the lower side, but you can actually go with, this is of course just to one stream, and if you are talking about 3-4 streams per view, then it sort of starts to multiply. And of course, if you are considering that the content might be created at multiple sites, particularly with the 3D, then it might be even more. So the bandwidth requirements are very sort of serious issue as well. Another very, very important issue in a multi-stream, multi-view aspect is that the streams are correlated. So you basically are, I mentioned, you saw the picture, camera 6 and camera 5, right? They are showing parts of the body of the dancer or of whatever content you are seeing. If those are not synchronized, you are getting sort of a shift. This is actually, when we built our teleimmersive testbed, we had the cameras that we had didn't have wide enough field. And so we actually had to put one camera on top of to take the upper body and one camera taking the lower body. But of course, those two streams had to be contributing to one view, had to be synchronized. And so there is this multi-stream dependency, and if you don't pay attention to the synchronizations of these streams, or in Video 360 camera, the tiles, you can have this kind of sort of shifted view, right? And that's, again, not a desired goal. Well, and then the last but not least challenge with respect to these multi-stream view type of problems is that, as I mentioned, you actually can change the view, right? You want to see the dancers from the right, from the left, from the center, and so on. So it's definitely something to consider that we haven't had in a TV distribution, even now, basically, with the various aspects of 2D distribution. Now, in the video streaming with a single camera but multiple lenses, there actually interfaces are starting to come where you can actually navigate, right, around the view. But it's, again, it's all stored, pre-computed, and it's sort of, you can have all the data there. When you start to think about distribution, just too much bandwidth, right, to send all the views. And so from the networking distributed systems point of view, you need to somehow chunk the 360 videos into multiple views, multiple streams, multiple tiles, whatever your model is, and then decide which are you going to send and then resend and cache and so on. So this is basically something that any distribution system will need to consider. So I'm going to talk about the system telecast that we have been working on, and I think it has some very interesting solutions that might be very interesting for overall live distribution broadcast. So the architecture for the 4D telecast basically consists of the producer sites. Those are the sites that are generating the content. If it is the camera with multiple lenses, if it is cameras around the sports field, or if it is your rendered video content from these two different dancer sites. And we also have to very carefully design what does the viewer see? What is on your laptop or maybe on some gateway coming to your laptop? And there, basically, we do assume that there is some kind of gateway, might be set-top box, might be actually even Comcast might have some outside box that it manages. But it basically, you need some kind of viewer management. On your laptop or mobile phone probably will be some kind of sort of renderer. You do need to consider basically what sits close to the non-immersive viewers. So we do assume a global session control management because if you have a broadcast content, right? You are watching a basketball game and there is a central session controller that needs to control all these streams and the views and the viewers. So we do assume a central global session controller that controls actually the producer sites as well as the non-immersive viewers. And of course, then the global session controller will have a monitoring capabilities as well as management. And this particular controller at the control plane needs to actually talk to the local session controllers. The local session controllers are usually in each of these gateways or closer to the non-immersive viewers. To communicate and understand what particular views, what kind of metadata need to be exchanged, what bandwidth currently can be allocated to that viewer, and also with respect to formation of the trees, distribution trees that need to deliver the various streams and the views. And so you basically need to have a very strong component of a stream subscription or view subscription. Because remember, I mentioned, imagine the user wants to control the view. I want to decide, not my NBC or ABC producer, I want to decide what view I want to have. So we will be talking about this stream subscription or view subscription because I want to actually then tell as a non-immersive viewer to the local, global and local management what I want. So that's basically it's sort of the overlay. And the content distribution then happens, this is the data plane, basically happens sort of separately once the control plane agrees on what needs to be delivered where, and stream and adapt. So, there definitely has to be infrastructure management. It has to be 3D management, bandwidth management, stream dependency management, view change management. As I said, a lot of components. I mentioned that there is more problems than basically I can solve and some of the colleagues. So I'm hoping that this is something that we sort of continue as a community, but also as researchers. So I am going to talk about two aspects, the infrastructure management and the multi-stream dependency. I think some of the bandwidth management, we have papers, but also, as I said, there are some more traditional techniques we have deployed. And very little I'm going to talk about the view change management. Again, that's a very, very active area of research. In terms of organizing, remember I mentioned we have the producer plane where the content, multi-camera, multi-view content get generated, and we want to get to the various viewers. So what we will do is we will actually use CDNs and the content distribution networks. What at this point happens, for example, in Comcast, in Netflix, is that they actually generate content, then they do put it into these sort of intermittent servers for a short period of time. It's usually 5 minutes. And then during these 5 minutes, they will analyze content. Now, at this point, they are mandated to analyze the content for indecency content. Okay, so that kind of live broadcasting is still has some delays, right? And we are counting on that in some way, because some of the view management still needs some time. But the live broadcasting is at this point sort of understood. And in these CDN networks, as intermittent servers, caches, we expect that regulators will actually provide certain requirements, what content can go to live broadcasting to the viewers. So, and then actually one thing that we are proposing is that these particular peers, these viewers, do get organized in some peer-to-peer fashion and get organized like sort of the trees. So, as I mentioned, in the CDN, there is a certain anticipation to some degree following the architecture that already Netflix and Comcast and some of these other distribution organizations are using. You have distribution servers, then there are some core servers that do some analysis, and then you have these edge servers that basically content gets cached and distributed. So the big question for us in terms of researchers was, how can we organize the viewers that are going to be requesting views? So let's assume these are the various users, and they are all requesting views, a view that consists of stream 1, 2, and 3, 1, 2, 3, and so on. I do want to comment that we will be actually looking at streams that come from site A, site B, sometimes on site C. So if the request comes on the client side, you basically need to get stream 1, 2, and 3 to get your view 1. Also, this particular user needs to get stream S1, S2, and S3, and so on. And we do want to organize them in a peer-to-peer manner. So in this particular case, for example, this user is caching S1 and then basically serves as a server to this user to put S1. This particular stream, S2 and S3, is coming from the CDN server. And some later users, basically, they want stream S1, S2. They get it from their peers. And S3 is not maybe available already, then they basically get the S3 from the CDN server. That's usually the peer-to-peer consideration. And in our view model of these multiple streams consisting, representing a view, this would be manifesting itself. So let's look at now our streams, which are not independent. They are very dependent on each other. Remember, top camera, lower camera representing a view, those streams have to come together to be viewed. So in some way, you have now a view that consists of, from the site A, stream 1 and stream 2. And this particular view is viewed by the user 1, by the user 2, and by the user 3. So everybody's getting the same view. I just want to make it simple as to explain this complexity of the view and the streams within that particular view. So important issue of the stream dependency is that the view 1 consists of stream 1 and stream 2 from the side A. And each viewer will have a buffer because these streams are coming through internet network, they can have a delay. So let's assume this particular stream S1A comes at the beginning and it basically is fine. It is within the buffer length, but the other streams comes too late. right? So you might already be gone with the friend. So if this is happening, then this particular frame of this particular stream might get dropped because it's too late. In multimedia streaming, late packets are lost packets. And so what could happen is that you are seeing top of the person and not the bottom, right? So these kind of delays, and therefore in this multi-stream dependency, the routing becomes very important. How do you route it to the viewer and keep this kind of sync, sort of sync very much in mind? So in some way, then this particular poor user gets the S1A, but doesn't get the S2 stream. So it is an important parameter on your client side how big the buffers will be, right? To actually help you to deliver the streams of a view in a synchronized manner. And one other thing that you have to consider how big that particular buffer will be is that you can actually also have a lot of victim streams and waste of bandwidth, because that particular stream might get maybe cached and it's not being used. So a really, really important parameter. And we just basically saw when you are requesting on the x-axis the total number of requested streams. And if the request stream is too big, here is basically each viewer requests six streams, then you know, the more streams you might request, you might actually start violating because of the bandwidth demands and the delays and maybe the depth of your peer tree, right? How you organize the tree, you can introduce a lot of victims. It means that a lot of streams might be missing what you are expecting. So these are some of the tests on the Planet Lab that we use. So I mentioned that one really important aspect for the multi-stream dependency and the overall stream distribution per view really requires a careful consideration of the buffering and also of the stream subscription. Because you basically want to do very careful maximization of the efficient resource utilization. You want to minimize the number of wasted bandwidth, minimize the number of victims, users that are getting upper part but not the lower part, or are getting part of the person's view and not the other. And the constraints, of course, are the difference, delay difference is bounded by the buffer size, right, that each viewer basically has. And remember, in the streaming, basically, you are getting one frame after another, so the buffer is only limited. And by the time maybe you know, your corresponding correlated frame already arrives, you cannot accommodate it. You have to drop it. So you need to minimize bandwidth waste, you need to minimize victim streams, and therefore bound delay variation by the debuff. So I am going to talk about one sort of idea how to think about this stream correlation and buffering together so that you are achieving the minimization of the bandwidth waste, minimization of the victim. And that particular aspect is really defined by what do we accept in terms of the size of the buffer. So we, as I mentioned, for us, important aspect at the receiver side, at the viewer side, is that these streams do come within the debuff type of space and size. So both of these streams of the view one arrive, and that actually we will consider as a consistent view. We actually also allow a little bit of a deskew, which is a little small delay that we might sort of allow, where the second stream correlated to S1A comes, and we do allow that. So we basically debuffer plus some sort of epsilon deskew. But of course, if a stream arrives way, way late, then that will really represent inconsistent view. You can see here, one view comes, one stream comes, second stream comes, and when you compose them together are these really undesirable artifacts. So the subscription is really aiming for bringing correlated streams within the delay bound of debuff plus dsq. And as I mentioned, this will be guiding how these individual viewers will get correlated in a peer-to-peer system. If we ask them to go to the CDN, or if we ask these viewers, get some of the content from your neighbor. So the stream subscription is basically for each received streams, we want to understand the end-to-end delay. So that's actually really important, you know, how much delays. You know that here is currently somewhere the producers of the 360 video, they get temporarily stored here, but then the question is how long do you want to accept that these users are getting the videos. One important aspect I want to comment in the distribution systems, Comcast, many of these, Netflix, YouTube, when they start to think about broadcasting, they do want to deliver the content at the same time. And the at the same time is maybe within a couple of seconds. So just watch sometimes when you have a television and multiple television devices, right? You are watching the same game. The content does get delivered pretty, very, very closely, right? Maybe there is 1 second delay. For example, in bedroom and in the living room, we sometimes are seeing 2 to 5 seconds delay, right? Sort of what the content is coming. But that's a requirement that you basically want these users get the content sort of together, right, at the same time. I'm not sure why it comes in these distribution networks, probably if there are some other regulations that they require. As I said, they have regulations for distribution networks to check on the content, but also delivering the content within approximately the same bounds. So that's also a requirement for us. So among the dependent streams, we want to determine the delay variation. If delay difference is violated, enforce bound, and then if violation cannot be fixed, partos, the view is not delivered, you just basically reallocate resources. So here is currently the approach, how we are thinking about the delivering to everybody codependent streams within approximately the same delays. So we actually divide the delays into layers. Okay? And we basically, from the CDN, as we have these various viewers, we anticipate that every viewer will sit within one delay layer. And the delay layer is basically, this could be 2 seconds, 2 seconds, 2 seconds. How far are you away from the CDN? And so this is basically your sort of end-to-end delay, whatever you accept. You could actually say, I am only two layers. Maximum from the CDN is going to be 4 seconds or 10 seconds or maybe less. So we basically introduce the layers that sort of helps us as a concept to then decide where particular client is going to be sitting, if that client is going to connect to another peer, or the client actually goes directly to the CDN and gets the content, okay? So we have this sort of, this is tau, is basically this whatever overlay overhead is currently in the CDN. But then important aspect is these layers, delay layers, they will have a certain size, and I will try to at least at the high level explain what these delay layers, how does this kind of parameter maps out. So here are the delay layers. You basically have a producer content. Then you have the servers that are temporarily storing your 360 video. And then basically you are having these layers where you need to place the various viewers so that they are receiving the delay, the content within particular buffering delay so that they can actually display the content together. And so we are going to show it on the example. I have a viewer, one view, one consisting of streams S1 and S2. And as you can see here, I currently have one user gets S1, and here is another sort of user getting S2, and then might propagate it to another. So this user U, for example, is in the layer one, delay layer one for stream S1, and into the second layer to get the stream S2. And so the belonging, deciding which layers you might want to be placed as a viewer in that peer-to-peer system, it basically is guided by this particular equation where you are taking into account what is the delay at this point of your parent minus whatever is basically the delay here. So you are actually really interested in this particular delay, the propagation delay, and then some processing time forwarding the data to this particular delay. So that sort of will drive which particular layer you might be in. So here the layer S2 for this user would be this particular delay plus this particular delay, whatever processing is here, divided by the layer size. And that sort of drives which particular layer you get placed. Now, the layered rings are very much important to be correlated with the buffers that these peers, that these viewers have. So we need to somehow tie this tau, right? You might sort of say, okay, 2 seconds is going to be one layer of the delay. And I put anybody peers that is having 2 seconds delay from this particular content distribution, I put in the layer one or layer two. But if that's your decision, then you better have enough space, buffering, that can handle the 2 seconds and more. So the debuff, the delay bounce, is really important to correlate to the tau. And so as you can see, the size of your layer will be very much depending on the buffer that each of your clients and each of your viewers will have. And of course, our goal will be that keeping this delay bound smaller than the buffer so that both of these streams of the view come at the same time. And so if we can basically keep this kind of sort of bounds, correlate the delay ring delay plus depending on the buffer that you have, you might have really strong design not to have any victims and not to have bandwidth waste. So here I just want to show you an example. For example, you have at this point user one, user two, and user three. They all want to have stream from side A, S1, and stream from S1B, from the side B. So the user one gets S1A, S1B immediately from the content distribution network. The user one gets also S1 stream from C site. Remember, we have producers now that are producing site content in all three sites simultaneously. The user two actually is still quite closely located. And so it gets the S1A from the user one. It's still within the tau layer. User two gets the S1B, user two gets S1C, and they can render it and they can watch it nicely. So user one, user two are seeing all the streams of the view nicely together. User three is maybe further, and so it basically gets put into this layer one. But with the layer four, with this particular stream, for whatever reason, there is a long delay, and so it gets put into the layer four. So these are some of the issues that you do need to then remedy and use certain delays and have a capability that you actually maybe delay some of the streams, cache them longer to basically, or this particular user caches them and keeps them longer before it displays so that the difference between the stream S1A, S1B, and S1C is no more than one. Because otherwise, you get totally out of sync. Okay? So these are maintaining these bounds, the streams that are coming together for the view, and really thinking carefully about the delays. And this is going to be the same thing about the tiles. Of the video 360 will have to be done. So I think I just finalized this particular project. The 3D telecast has really important aspect of registrations of the streams per view, whatever view you want. It works with the global session control, local session control to stream detection, to bandwidth allocation, creating the topology. Those delays rings and the communication of the user one, user two, user three, that's all creation, formation of the peer-to-peer streaming trees. And that basically happens in this particular sort of protocol. And at this point, some of the results are supporting that basically we can use a maximum layer of accepted streams. We can go up to 18. And if we can have multiple layers streams, we can deliver them, deliver content to many, many viewers more and more. Also, number of streams a viewer receives, you can go from sort of smaller numbers to sort of larger numbers of the users that basically can receive number of streams and share them. So in terms of the view change, I only talked about I have a view, multiple streams, how do I set up, format this peer-to-peer streams. When you do view change, you decide to see something else, we usually go back to the CDN and have recreation of some of those trees. Viewer is added into the overlay in the background. And so the viewer joining is an expensive operation because you have to very carefully, again, think about in which layer of the delay you are putting your new viewer. But view change, basically gets much faster done. You go just to the CDN to get whatever views, yeah. And then you are sort of in the background creating sort of the next tree. So I very quickly want to talk about extension that I have done with my students on the 3D amphitheater. I think it's a really neat idea. The big problem for us in the 4D telecast was that we actually assumed people to go for any number of streams, any number of views you basically could do. And that is quite limiting. So what we started to do is look at if we do have a virtual stage, right? You have a room with multiple cameras, 360, or even multiple rooms that you are rendering. but we basically look at this particular virtual 360 space and basically say, these are going to be seats, like in a theater. Now also here, when you are sitting, you are just seeing certain view. You don't see something from the back, right? So we started to introduce the concept of virtual seat. And in the virtual seat, basically, every user gets attached to a particular seat. You could change seat, right? But with this attached fixed position, then you have only certain view, right? It's not like you can go to any view, right? So, you basically can sort of think about it like a virtual opera glasses. And then actually, if you think about these kind of virtual seats, you might have much more effective content sharing when you are thinking about audience. So, you basically can then, for a particular seat, you can allocate multiple people. Here, for example, you are sort of looking from this side, and then behind you, everybody gets the same view, right? So you can now, instead of this more complicated, remember, delivering, and you have to decide which particular viewer am I attaching to which particular peer, here you get assigned 1C, 2C, 3C in your table, in your seat, and you get that particular content. So the content then basically gets much easier formulated in terms of a structure. And then, we also explored not only the stream differentiation. So this is currently, for example, what we did. I talked about the stream prioritization ranking, the most important streams, and then some of the side streams are lower priority. So I could, for bandwidth reason, remove them. But we started also to differentiate the streams based on a role. And my student Shannon actually sort of said, when I go to a play of my child, I don't want to see other children. I want to see a view of my child, right? Even though he or she might not be the main role, but I want to see it. So, and that's the view I want to. So it's not just who is currently in that particular view, but also based on the role. And that actually allowed us then to look at sort of much more interesting trees, how to deliver the data. So this is currently, again, following very similar approach as in for the telecast, that we have the publishers publishing content to a CDN. Then we have the session management brokers that are basically getting the stream view role subscription. You get a seat assigned. And then basically there is a whole establishment per tree, per role, your seat, streams to the seat, and tree to deliver that particular view. And we have basically seen with this limitation, right? Much more than, much smaller rejection rate, right? So if I look at telecast, because we allow anybody and everybody, sort of to join and therefore any view, and there basically the delay rings also are constraining how far can you be away from other peers. That actually cost us some users to reject where with the amphitheater building a tree based on the particular virtual seat was giving us much, much smaller rejection rate based on number of audience. Also, we have been looking at the application quality of service and in terms of the quality of the streams that we have to deliver, and satisfaction. And that was, again, with respect to the semantic awareness in the amphitheater, was a much, much better way than in the 4D telecast. We also have been looking at some of the service quality of performers and they're here currently selecting the streams and the trees based on the virtual seed, again, give us a better satisfaction than this is currently the algorithms that we have been working on, where we randomly selected peers and then randomly build up the tree. And that, of course, then has much lower satisfaction. And the last thing I want to sort of show is the effect of these virtual seeds. You can think about this virtual seat also as if I have audience or if I have just the real-time people exchanging data. And we definitely, with the virtual seats, are seeing much better performance than if we, in particular with respect to audience or without audience, you can see that the with audience is even better because you have sort of more people you have more buffering, you have sort of more flexibility. If you don't have audience, and this is just a distribution among real-time peers, you might see some rejection ratio because you are dealing with real-time, much tighter bounds than in the distribution when you have audience. So I do want to finalize, and this is my last slide. It's a little bit busy, but I do want to comment on one really important aspect that I think in the Video 360 and in the broadcasting distribution of these live sessions, we have to look at. And one of the things I believe we have to look at the semantics. One semantics that we have been looking at is the view. Mapping the view and then the streams into the distribution system helped us to decide which particular resources to allocate. And that's a really, really important thing for quality of experience, right? If you just randomly select any streams, people are not going to be happy. So what I think that has to happen is that between these various applications, particular real-time applications, broadcast application, distribution applications, we do have to look at the environment, the activity. For example, if I know the role, that's the application semantic information, I could give you much better satisfaction, even though I don't send all of the data. Right? So semantics, I think that's, or user role. And that actually then basically should lead to some kind of middle layers, translation layers that are much more at the capturing level, maybe put metadata that talk about activity, talk about some metadata about compression. In the dissemination, we might sort of look at the virtual seeds or sort of, and that actually being used in the forest distribution tree creation. And on the receiving side, if there is a user role, you can basically just put those streams into account. And I think that if we can understand these various semantics, if it is hand gestures, if it is role, if it's doctor, patient, I think we can much better solve this tension between content complexity, resource requirement, and user satisfaction. So that sort of concludes my talk. This has been work with many different participants and students and my collaborators at Berkeley. Anyway, it was just really great to ride and is going to be a more ride in this area.